Good morning, fam. Great to be alive. Great to see another day. As you all can see, I am here with my best friend. I got her out to do this with me today. This will be our first time doing a Sunday together.
Yes.
Hallelujah. So we had a great time preparing for this moment, and it's been a long, great week. Just talking to each other. And I pray that we kind of had church in here yesterday, and I just pray that what we experienced together will translate over to wherever you guys are, and that God will bless you, and then all will go well. And so with that being said, let's bow our heads and pray to the Father.
Father God, we come before you, Lord, to say thank you. Thanking you, Father, for this opportunity, Lord. Thanking you, Father, for this moment, Lord. We ask, Father, as we prepare to speak to your people today, Father God, that you use us, Father God, that you empty out everything that is not of you, Father God, that you pour in, Father, what you would have us to say, Lord. Father God, that it may touch someone on the other side, Father God, that they may experience you, Father God. They may get an answer, Father God, to a question that they have been pondering, Lord. We thank you, Father God, again for this opportunity. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. All right. So continuing on what we've been talking about for the last few weeks, starting with Jill and Deron about a week ago, probably at this point, talking about Lift Every Voice. This is part three. We're going to call this part three. This is our contribution to Lifting Every Voice. And so we're going to just jump right into it and see where God takes us with this. All right, so with that being said, my team that's working with us today, y'all can go ahead and pull the first slide up, and we're going to just start right there. Boom, there it is. All right, so wherever you are, let's just read that together. Talking about Lift Every Voice. And so let's read that out loud. It says, in order to lift your voice, you have to know what message is waiting in your mouth. The message in your voice is birthed by experience, trauma, testimony, and I just added one more that's not on there, study and chatter. You can bring that down. In order to lift your voice, you have to know what message is in your mouth. You have to know, in order for you to start raising your voice, like, I got something to say. You got to know first and foremost what message is in your mouth. Because the message that's in your mouth may not need to be told. Because the messages that's in our voice that want to come out, they come from different ways. They come from the trauma we've experienced in our life. Mm-hmm. They've come from the trauma we've overcome in our life, and that has now become our testimony, which means you got something to say. They come from what you've studied. Meaning it's just information. It's just come from what you study. Or it can come from chatter. And for those of you that have been watching The Soul Factory for a few weeks now, we've been talking about the book Chatter that we've read. We had the privilege of doing the book read together and understanding that chatter is basically that voice that should not be lifted. Because chatter is that voice that is destructive. It is a destructive voice. You got anything to add? Because I'm going to keep going.
No.
All right. And so from there, we're going to go to this next slide. It's like, so know what message is in your mouth before you lift your voice. Next slide. Why is it important? Because not knowing what message is in your voice causes you to elevate the wrong message. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Not knowing what message is in your voice causes you to elevate the wrong message. Do you know what message is waiting on the other side of your lips?
And typically, your message is going to be wherever you are in this, whether you are in the midst of your trauma, in the midst of your testimony, being freed from it, in the midst of your chatter, in the midst of your study, wherever you are at that moment, that's the voice that's going to be lifted.
And so with her saying that, that means that a constant inventory has to be taken as to my today state.
Right.
A constant inventory has to be taken as to where is my spirit? Where is my mind? Where are my emotions today or in this moment?
Right.
And as we know, moments change constantly, every time. We just had a moment where we started service. That moment of starting service is over. We're now in the moment now where we're at the beginning of this message.
Right.
We're in a whole different moment.
Right.
And in this new moment, we have to know and have taken an inventory so that as we carry on, we're not taking the wrong message or the wrong words into the next moment. I hope that makes sense. Did that make sense to
you? That makes sense.
And so why is this important? It's important, and we bring this up because here's the gist of it in two words. Words matter. Mm-hmm. Words matter. What you speak out of your mouth makes a difference. What's going on in your head, the conversations in your head, those words matter.
Right.
They matter because they are causing you to do or not to do something that should be in your space or not in your space. Mm-hmm. Words matter. Let's go to the first scripture. Next slide. It should be Proverbs.
Proverbs 13:3.
You can go ahead.
And it says, whoever is careful about what he says protects his life, but anyone who speaks without thinking will be ruined.
Whoever is careful about what he says. Bring that back up real quick. Whoever is careful, can you bring it back up? Thank you. I love you guys. Whoever is careful, leave it up just for a second. Whoever is careful about what he says protects his life. You can bring it down. I just need to remember the rest. Whoever is careful about what he or she says protects their life. The statement I just made said that words matter. And then we follow that up with the word of God that says, if you're careful about the words that come out of your mouth, if you're careful with them, you protect your own life. You protect yourself. You protect the people that you care about and love when you are careful about the words that come out of your mouth. But if you are reckless with them,
right,
you become ruined.
Right. And you know this to be true because in everyday situations, everyday life, if you say the wrong thing in a moment, right? We, as a married couple, we go through that a lot, right? You could be talking, sit on the couch, looking at something. I ask a question. He asks a question. And in that moment, I could speak something negative, something derogatory, say something flippant. And all of a sudden, that moment now is adjusted. Now we're entering into a new moment because of offense. Right, because now I'm angry about what you said or how you said something because you just did it without thinking, right? You just running off at the mouth.
And sometimes you can be running off at the mouth thinking that I was just joking.
Right.
In my own mind, in my own heart, I really meant no offense. But depending on who you're dealing with in relationship, they either gonna tell you straight up
right.
that what you just said came out wrong, or they're not gonna say nothing at all. And your little jokey joke that you just let slip out your mouth has brought her ruin.
Right.
But now she's not telling me that it's brought her ruin, but her whole attitude and situation has changed. But I don't find out until later that she was mad.
Right. Right.
Especially depending on how you hide your energy.
Right.
Because we got some great energy hiders.
Right.
And if I'm in jokey joke mode, that means I'm playing. I'm not looking for your energy.
Right.
Which means I don't even know that you've been offended until I try to come get close to my wife later on and she's trying to elbow me.
Now I got to see. Well, I'm sitting on the couch playing a game on my phone in order to let him go to sleep.
Ignoring me, hoping that I fall asleep.
Right, so I have to deal with him.
Mm. Yeah, y'all hear what she just said, right? I'm just, okay. We're going to pray on that one. Hallelujah. All right, moving on. So, why is that important? Is this a slide?
No.
Okay, my personal note. The words that I speak can either make. Is that right?
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Bring out the next slide. It is a
slide four.
Slide four. There is a weight associated with every word that we speak. Wherever you are, don't take it down yet. Bring it back. Bring it back. I appreciate y'all being so on it this morning, though. Bring it back. Y'all on fire right now. But there is a weight associated with every word we speak. I want everybody at home just to say it out loud. Hear your voice say, there is a weight associated with every word that we speak. Now you can bring it down. When I say there's a weight associated with every word we speak, I right before I came in here, I went to my gym and I grabbed a couple of weights because I'm going to use both terms weight. There's the W-E-I-G-H-T weights,
right.
Those, these weights, and then there's the weight, W-A-I-T, that Jill and Deron talked about a week ago. What we just said is that the weight of your words can make somebody heavier or lighter.
Right.
Meaning, I have words that I can just pass on and everything's all right. And you can give it back to me and everything's still all right. Right now, we're just having a conversation.
Right.
We're having a conversation. But right now, the conversation about to get a little bit heavier. Right. All right. So now you got to put a little bit more effort and a little more focus into this conversation.
Right.
All right. But at some point, you got to be a discerning individual, because at some point in this great conversation, you can switch it up and be like, boom, here. I ain't gonna do that to you.
Okay.
Okay. I ain't trying to mess with her strength. But at some point, hold this, since you got it.
Yeah, put it on my
lap. No, hold it. Don't put it on your lap. I ain't gonna let you hold it too long. But at some point, something was said, and I neglected to remember that there was weight to my words.
Right.
And so now she's walking around holding the weight of what I just dropped on her. And I don't even realize how heavy it is, the thing that I just put on her.
Right, right.
And so now she's over here getting tired. Her arms getting shaky.
Yeah.
She's getting annoyed because she's holding this weight.
Right.
She's wishing that I would just take it back right now. Just take it from me.
Right.
Because I look cute. I got dressed up for service. I did not come in here to hold your funky weights. Hold the weight, babes.
It's heavy.
You hear this? That's the point. Let me help. But notice, see, the longer she had to hold that weight, she could no longer even hold in the complaint, especially when I'm pushing on how you got to hold that weight.
Right.
If I'm pushing how you got to hold that weight, I'm not going to let you put it on your lap. I'm not going to let you forget that it's there.
Right.
Because I keep bringing it up. I keep pushing it, not realizing that I'm making things heavier.
Right.
And now, y'all, you know, she held it together, but she was getting annoyed for real. See, I know her. She's getting annoyed for real. It's like, if you don't move on to the next point and get this weight up out of my hand, we're going to have real problems when the camera go off. You notice she ain't disagreeing with me, though. There's weight to your words. What I just showed you was what waiting in relationships look like. Man, it ain't got to be husband and wife, but when you're having a conversation, just passing words back and forth, you know, sometimes the conversation gets heavy, and that's fine.
Right.
But you deal with it. But you don't allow one portion of this relationship in this conversation with these words to sit there and hold on to a weight longer than they should. Mm-hmm. Not when you have the power to lighten that load.
Right.
I hope that makes sense to you. So a few years ago, this is where this came from and where we started talking. A few years ago, long and short of it, she had a ridiculously stupid husband. She had a ridiculously stupid husband that kept piling on weight. Mm-hmm. I was piling on the weight of my bad decisions. I was piling on the weight of the way I spoke to her, trying to protect myself from my bad decisions and her response to them. Mm-hmm. She had to deal with the fallout from outside of me, from the bad decisions. And not only that, I'm shielding myself, trying to protect myself, not realizing that not only am I forcing this woman to hold all of this weight, but now I'm giving her 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 more of these plates.
Right.
And I'm daring her to hold on to these, and not only hold on to them, but hold on to them and hold on to me at the same time. She had a stupid husband. What am I talking about? Because this, the weight of relationships. So imagine this. She's walking around with all these weights that I put there, but I still want her to be there for me.
Right.
But I don't want to carry or lighten those weights. As a matter of fact, I'm so stuck in my own head and my own chatter conversations that I don't even understand or can't even see how heavy the weight that she's holding. So I can't take anything from her right now. Mm-hmm. And so now But in all of this, I'm praying to be a better man. In all of this, I'm praying for a better marriage. I'm praying for great kids. I'm praying to get my life in order. I'm praying to be right. Because where I am in my life is not where I know I'm supposed to be or where I want to be. I'm praying to be in a space. And so while I'm praying to be in a space, I'm also now in that other weight, W-A-I-T.
Right, right. And then what he doesn't realize is the weight that he, the W-E-I-G-H-T that he's putting on me is on top of the weight that I've already taken, right? On top of the weight that I've never given up, right? So on top of how I view myself, how I feel, the shame, right, of my own decisions, on top of his decisions, everything that you can think of, the guilt, right, that you're feeling. And so now I'm weighted down, right? I'm weighted down to where, you know, in the relationship, you know, I'm dealing with now mental issues, right? Unhealthy thoughts about myself, about us, right? As he still wants me to go along and pretend that everything is okay.
Right. So my note here that I have is her weight was in a space of extreme pain and mental disorder thanks to your decisions, Will. And her weight, W-A-I-T, we're talking about while waiting. When I'm saying waiting right now, we're waiting on God.
Right.
We're waiting on God. And so her weight is in extreme pain and mental disorder while my weight was in a space of guilt, shame, fear, and mental disorder. Right. Why do I have those many things? Because I'm the one that's making bad decisions.
Right.
Because I'm the one that's not doing what God is calling me to do. Right. And so because of that, and so I'm doing all of this, and the guilt and shame is heavier, just like Rib and Renee talked about at the conference. The guilt and the shame on me is heavier because I'm supposed to be above reproach because you're a leader.
Right.
I'm not supposed to fall like this because you're a leader. I don't know anything but service when it comes to God.
Right.
But now I'm in this season because I made a lot of bad decisions. And so now I'm not being allowed to serve the way I want to serve or the way I'm used to serve. Mm-hmm. Because the wonderful pastors that I serve under, they could discern that you needed to be still in your weight, W-A-I-T, right now.
Right.
But me not wanting to deal with that directly head on, I ain't trying to wait like that. I got to do something.
Right.
And so I thank God, and I thank you, Deron and Jill, for that season. They already know all the details. But I thank Deron and Jill that in that season, at least they let a brother play card.
Right.
At least they let a brother play Congo. Because see, let me be real honest and shame the devil right here. Because let me tell y'all something right now. If I wasn't at least able to play Congos, where I was mentally in that space of my bad decisions and fighting for my marriage and fighting for my relationship with God, do you realize that I probably felt like I would have left?
Right.
Because everybody had to pull back from me so that God can get in front of everybody else. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't see or find God if I'm still trying to please man. And so, but being able to just play an instrument and say, look, God, this is all I got. Can a brother just bang on some drums for you?
Right.
Just to let me feel some kind of connection.
Right.
And so I thank God for that. I never thanked Deron and Jill for that, but thank you for that.
Right.
It was not in vain. Lord knows, we ain't supposed to be here. We wouldn't be here.
No.
We wouldn't be here because in that season, we thought everything was about us because the chatter was so loud.
The chatter was so loud. You can have a moment, you know, every service, every sermon, every TV show. You can walk into the grocery store. Somebody could say something and I would think they knew my situation. But this was due because of what I was carrying, right? The voices in my own head, right? My voice became so heavy. It's like earlier, Moncloud blessed us with the script that she read, right? Because sometimes you forget that under that weight, right? It starts to feel like you're going to be crushed. It starts mm-hmm. to feel like you can't go on. The other thing about that that I had like in my notes is that it feels uncomfortable, right? And we experience that W-A-I-T differently, right? And so where Will, his weight sometimes looks like, you know, 2 days later, Will good. Will like, all right, he done dealt with it in his mind. He done put it. He was like, look, I messed up. You know what I'm saying? And he's like, you know, but I believe God can change me overnight. I'm going to change. He wanted to go along. Joy is in looking at this Joker like, he is tripping, right? Lord, he is. I want fire and brimstones coming down, right? But then what we had to realize, especially in that season a few years ago, is his weight looked different. My weight looked different. Even though there may be some similarities in it, it still was different, right? And like my weight and other people's weight may look similar and we could become empathetic, but he had to realize he couldn't rush me to get to the point that he was, right? That just because in his situation, he dealt with his stuff 2 days, he feeling like he good, he a changed man, he committed, right? Mine took longer, right? Because now all of that other weight, right, that I'm carrying, all of that shame, all of that guilt, all of the guilt and shame that came from me and basically trying to cope, right? So now I have vices to cope with these feelings because I'm feeling crushed under this weight and all I can hear is the chatter. So he had to allow me to take that time to get healed, and my healing looked different than his healing.
Right, because the bottom line, we're both walking around like this.
Right.
I can see life. I hope this pans through the camera, but I can see life, but there's a hole in the middle of this thing. But my view of life is as big as that hole. That means I can't see what's happening on the outside. I don't have this whole picture.
Right, right.
What she's saying, I don't have this whole picture. All I have is that view where I can see her. I can feel you. I love you, baby.
Right.
But all I have is this small view right here.
Right.
I had to wait, W-A-I-T, I had to wait for God to bring this view back.
Right.
Because in this view, it's not narrow. Right. It's not one-sided.
Right. And I had to be patient in that way, W-A-I-T, right? I had to be patient in that way because there are times when we're not patient in the way. We then don't allow God to finish his good work, right, in us, right? But if I'm feeling crushed, I can't hear the voice of God saying, Joy, hand me that way. And taking that off and feeling a little bit like, Joy, hand me this way. Joy, hand me that. Joy, hand me this. So that I can see that other side, right? That though at that moment, I may feel weighted down. I may feel like I'm crushed. I'm not destroyed. But in my mind, everything is telling me that all of this is set out to destroy me because I'm feeling uncomfortable.
And so that brings the question up. What does waiting feel like to you?
Right.
It's an important question because you got to know what you're, when I'm saying waiting, we're talking about the W-A-I-T now. Mm-hmm. While you're waiting on God, it's important to identify at least what you feel like. Right. Because at least if you know what you feel like, or can, you know, say, even if it's a, God, I don't even know. I feel crazy.
Right.
I can't put a name to it, but I know I'm feeling something, God.
Right.
I feel something, but it's important to at least express that you know that something is in my space while I'm waiting. Because that is how I need to talk to God.
Right.
From that space. God, I feel like I'm healed. And then keep your butt still so God can show you that you're not. Mm-hmm. God, I feel like I'm okay. But she ain't acting okay.
Right.
Then keep your butt still until I do what I gotta do.
Right.
Keep following my commands. Keep doing what I say. Dude, you've been out there. It's time to come back. It ain't just gonna be a step over the curb. You gotta step over a mountain right now.
Right.
What does waiting look like? What does waiting feel like?
Right.
The other question that I had is that in my waiting, because waiting can feel so heavy sometimes. That I got to ask myself the question, do I even have a future in my wait?
Right.
W-A-I-T, do I have a future in my wait?
Right.
My prayers had to get really real because especially with us, it got to a point where we had to ask, is there a future
here in
me waiting?
Right. For this.
For this moment, for something like this.
For this to get under control.
If
this to get under control.
If healing if God ain't real, we ain't here. I'm Lord. Her sisters know, and my brothers know. And I'm talking about the Soul Factory sisters and brothers that we let in. Just how raggedy a brother was. And I was dragging this beautiful queen through the mud. For what? Because of a season.
Right.
But understanding what season you're in, you gotta like, look at here. Do we have a future in this way?
Right.
I need to know.
Right. And that's where your patience is gonna come in. Right. That's what waiting on God for his appointed time is going to come in. But a lot of time we try to rush this process, y'all. We try to rush this process of wait because again, we don't want to feel uncomfortable in this, right? But there's a certain amount of uncomfortableness that has to happen for God to do the pruning, for God to do his work, right? So in this situation, for Will to see certain things that he either was blinded by or decided to be blinded by. Things that Joy had to see in herself, voices and things that I just put into the pack, weight that I kept carrying and wasn't healed from, all of that now is exposed, right? In this weight, right? But I want to move quick past this season, right? But God said, no, you need to wait. Some of us experience that kind of weight in this season of COVID. You had no choice but to sit there and be patient. You had no choice but to sit there and hear from God. You had no choice but to allow God to do a good work in you.
And so now with her going there, so the question now becomes, in this current season of wait for all of us, and I thank God for the book again, pastors, what's the chatter going on in your wait right now?
Exactly.
What chatter conversations are you having right now in this place of wait? So we talked about it briefly at the conference. You know, but that's more than just a conference day question.
Right.
That is a daily moment by moment question, because we're still in a situation as a world where things just ain't what we want them to be. Let's put it that way.
Right.
And so because of that, when things ain't what we want, chatter begins. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. When you don't get what you want, I don't get what I want, right. Chatter begins.
Right.
She ain't feeling you.
Right.
He ain't feeling you. Chatter, 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 right. Chitter, chitter, chatter.
Right.
What is the conversation
that's happening
right now in this current season of your life while right. You're waiting?
Even when he just says no to a small task, that chatter comes up. I could ask him, like this morning I asked him to go get the laundry basket. He did, right? But he could have also said no. And then in my head, I'm equating that no, right? That no, you don't love me. Because you didn't go get the laundry basket. And now I done gone 10 stories deep. You know what I'm saying? On this one, no. When he could have been tired. He could have been in the middle of something. There's a lot of reasons that he could have gave me no. But in my head, I equated that no to, you don't love me.
But I thank the Lord that that's just an example. And I went and got that basket.
He did go get the basket.
All right, moving on. All right, so with that being said, let's bring up the next scripture. I don't know what slide we're on.
Exodus.
The Exodus scripture.
Yeah, slide 5.
Thank you. Can you read that? I can't see.
Yeah. The whole Israelite community left the desert of Sin. They traveled from place to place as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water there for the people to drink. So they quarreled with Moses. They said, give us water to drink. But Moses said to them, why do you quarrel with me? Why are you testing the Lord? But the people were very thirsty for water, so they grumbled against Moses. They said, why did you bring us out of Egypt? Was it to kill us, our children, and our farm animals with thirst?
Let me tell you why we use this scripture. So that scripture, you can take it down now. Good job, everybody. I thank y'all for waiting. Let me tell you why we chose that scripture. Because in this conversation that she and I had that we're bringing to you today, we had to ask ourselves a couple questions. Number one, what do you believe and what do you want?
Right.
What do you believe and what do you want? And so using this scripture that we just read, those Israelites, they wanted freedom.
Right.
They wanted to get out of slavery. They wanted out of bondage. They wanted to see something new. They wanted what you told us we could get, that land flowing with milk and honey. We want that. What do you want? What do you want? What do you believe? And we ask, what do you want? Because now I have to say out loud, this is what I want. And I'm saying it now, when I say what I want, and I'm saying it to you, that means that I believe that me telling you can help me get to what I want. Does that make sense?
Right.
So if I tell God that I want something, I'm telling God because I have a belief that should he find favor on me, that he can give it to me.
Right.
If I pointed to you, let's say if I just use Ruth, you have something I want, and I ask you for it. I'm only asking you for it because I believe you have the power to give it to me.
Right, right.
Does that make sense to you?
Right,
okay.
Right. I was going to say, and with that particular group, right, with Moses, that particular scripture stands out because there's a lot of things that we believe and we want from God. But when he goes through his process of working it out, because we can't see that in time, then we're grumbling and crying against God. Lord, it's taking too long. Lord, is it this is what's coming out of my voice.
Right.
Right? Complaints, quarreling, you know, I don't want to do. So we use our relationship, right? Because I now want something, you know, out of him. You know, the flip side is, okay, yeah, 2-3 days. Maybe that really was enough time for God to speak, God to heal. But now I'm upset because I want a little bit more, God. I want him to suffer. I want him. But I've asked God, what do I want? I want a faithful husband. I want a husband free from his sin. I want these things, right? But because in my mind, I have it set up, well, I want him to also suffer a little bit too before he gets to that, see that freedom for my own benefit. Yes, I'm talking about revenge, right? Like, mm-hmm. You know, but now I'm courting against God. Right. But God said, but Joy, didn't you just say you wanted this? Didn't you believe that I could do this? Then you can't put a time frame on, at least on that part.
Right. And so yesterday I had asked you, we sat here and we just went back and forth. And I asked you straight up. I said, what do you want, baby?
Right.
I said, wait. And then I said, I wanted to be healed.
Right.
I'm doing what I'm doing. But, you know, anyone, all of us that understand falling understands that when you fall, you don't want to fall. But even before you fall, if you got any spirit of God in you, you're not comfortable in what you're doing.
Right.
You're not comfortable just being out there.
Right.
Because every time you turn around, God is still there and he's still talking to you.
Right.
And so now, God, I want that conversation to stop.
Right.
I want to not have this conversation of repentance with you every other day, God.
Right.
I want to have my prayers change from, Lord, please forgive me, to thank you, Lord. Right. For forgiving me, right. You know what I mean?
Right.
I want my relationships to work. I want my children to remain on the path of righteousness. This is just a little bit of something I wrote down. I want my connection to my spouse to be in a spiritual place that we have never seen or had before.
Right.
That's what I want. This is what I'm saying. What you want, Joy?
I said, I want to be free. I want to be whole. I want to be righteous. I want my words, right? I want to be functional. Right. I want my children, what they touch, to prosper. Right. It doesn't mean that they got to make a whole bunch of money or anything like that. I just want whatever endeavor they decide to take a part of. I just want it to prosper. You know, I want peace in this relationship, in this house. I want laughter. Right. I don't want to feel as if I got to be checking on you.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
And I don't want to be checked on.
Right.
I don't want the feeling of being checked on to remain.
Right.
Brothers that have been there, and sisters, you too, you dirty sometimes too. God bless us all. I don't want to not be able to do this.
Right.
Enjoy yourself. They didn't see it right. It's my phone. I don't want to not be able to do this.
Right.
I'm going to take a nap. Whatever. Hold that for me.
Right. Right.
When you riding dirty, you ain't doing this. So all of y'all that's hiding your phones, guess what? You riding dirty. You say what you want.
Right.
Game recognized, game player. But if you're riding dirt, but God, I don't want to have to feel like I'm hiding anything. God, I don't want to even hide from myself anymore.
Right.
I don't like who I am. I don't like what I'm doing. And I hate what who I am right now is doing to her and my children.
Right.
I don't want to be this.
Right. Right. And you made an important point, right? I don't want to hide from myself, right? I don't want to feel as though the things that I'm doing now, you know, is causing me to repent, causing me to go in a closet or someplace else because now I'm hiding from God. You can't hide from God. You know what I'm saying? But it's this feeling you're telling yourself, right, that what you're doing, no, God, I'm not going to do it again. I'm not going to do this again.
And so that brings us to the next part where it says, you know, Because we're talking about the words. So does my internal, my note here is, does my internal chatter and the words that come out of my mouth, does my prayer life, do my decisions, do my moments loudly declare what I want? Let me read that one more time. Does my internal chatter and the words that are coming out of my mouth, does my prayer life, are my current decisions and my current moments loudly declaring what I say I want? Mm-hmm. Meaning, is it matching up?
Right.
Is it matching up? Does the belief system that I say I have match what I say I want? Mm-hmm. Meaning, when I speak and I ask for something, I'm asking you because I believe that you can give it to me.
Right.
When I speak to the Lord, I'm asking for something or I'm declaring something because I believe that he will respond to me. Right. Does my belief system and the words coming out of my mouth, do they all match? Yeah. Ed spoke a great message on Wednesday where Ed was talking, and I encourage you all to check it out. Ed was talking about being connected, having right. connection to God.
Right.
Where it was similar to this, where, you know, I'm speaking certain things, I'm doing certain things,
right.
but there's no real connection there.
No.
That's just like us having a conversation.
Right.
We're going to stay married for now. We're going to hang right. together for now.
Right.
We're going
right.
to keep a good faith for our children for right. now.
Right.
We're here together, but right. we are not connected.
As Ed said, it's because of me thinking, it's a loose connection. Ed said that connection is loose. Right. So we now have a loose connection. So we only staying because, I don't know, it's more beneficial.
She ain't doing it right. The connection looked like this.
Right. It's more beneficial. You know what I'm saying? For monetary reasons, or we think, you know, because the kids, you know, need us. But do we really need this looseness? No, what we need this. Right. I need to know that this is my partner, you know.
And so if this is what you want, I got to ask, why are you complaining? Bring up the Luke text real quick, please. We're moving. Mm-hmm.
Luke 6:45 says, a good man brings good things out of the good stored up in his heart, and an evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in his heart. For the mouth speaks what the heart is full of.
Bring that back. His word. Say what you want. Say what you want, but what you are living,
right.
what has been sown in your space, what you are reaping right now. Say whatever you want, but what you are reaping right now in your space is actually what's in your heart.
Right.
You can say what you want, because we can lie to ourselves all day.
Right.
You can lie to yourself all day. Say what you want. Use whatever words make you feel better about your situation, life, and decisions.
Right. Right.
But what are you experiencing right now?
Right.
What fruit are you eating right now?
Right.
The fruit that you're eating right now, that's what was actually in your heart.
Right.
That's what you actually believe.
Right.
That's what you're actually, because that's what you sowed.
Right. Right.
Now, the good news is that if you don't like it, the great news is that keep sowing.
Right. Right.
Keep on sowing.
Right.
We were in a space where I didn't like it, but I wasn't planning on going nowhere. Not for real, for real. By all means, God, you got to do something with this, because I ain't going nowhere. So what did I do? I just had to keep sowing.
Right.
Smacking me with the words, smacking me physically, whatever she got to do. All right, you know what, God? I deserve it. Then let me go ahead and eat all that off your plate.
Right.
Keep giving it to me. I'm going to keep taking, you know what? I've earned that much.
Right. Right.
I've earned that much.
Right.
So let me go ahead and take it, because I don't like what I'm reaping right now.
Right.
And so, but I'm not going to stop sowing.
Right. Right.
So in spite of whatever this is, in spite mm-hmm. of it, I got to keep sowing what I want. You have something to add?
Mm-hmm.
And so that's that with Ed's note, that brings me back to the question. So what are you saying? Why are you complaining so much?
Right.
If you are reaping the fruits of complaining, it's because complaining is what's in your heart.
Right. Right.
Don't care what's coming out your mouth.
Right.
Just like the Israelites, when they were complaining to Moses, look, everything, yeah, they were out there in the wilderness. Yes, I believe it's the desert.
Right.
They were thirsty. I believe that. But these are colored folk that's hot and thirsty.
Right.
And when colored folk get a certain attitude about the leadership, colored folk act real funky. Mm-hmm. So I can only use my vivid imagination. And, you know, the words look nice in the Bible, the way they say we, they grumbled against Moses.
Right.
Nah, they was carrying Moses.
Right.
They was cursing this Negro out.
Right. Right.
Y'all know how we do when we don't like how somebody is running the situation that we ain't in charge of.
Right, right. And then with your with your note though about your internal chatter and words that come out your mouth matter. And it's because we've all played a game of I think some years ago, Deron, remember we made the mask and it was the mask that they're behind, right? The mask that they wear. Right. We all have been good at wearing a mask.
Right.
Right. So whether, you know, so while we're doing this today, you don't trust, this isn't a mask, but this could very well be a mask in prayer. I could be calling a prayer line. I could be doing my 10, 15, 20 minutes of prayer. But when I get off that, I could be cussing out my kids. I could be cussing out my husbands. Why? Because of what's stored in my heart. That's real for that moment and for that momentary time. I can play the game, right? But what's internal, what's coming out my mouth, the things I say, my belief system, you're going to see in my day-to-day life. You're going to see it in the way I treat my spouse, in the way I treat my friends, in the way I treat my kids, the way I act on my job. That, so when you look at that, that's what's coming out. That's the fruit that you're bearing.
Right. And so with that being said, let's bring up that next slide. It goes right into that. Let's read that together. Conversation is not connection. Mm-hmm. Let's say that one more time, wherever you are. I actually felt in the spirit. I heard you speak it. Say it one more time, a little bit with more heart. Conversation is not connection. Mm-hmm. We have fallen into a false sense of security due to our ability to converse on spiritual matters. Just because you can do spiritual activities doesn't mean you are connected to the spirits. You can take that down. Mm-hmm. Back in the spiritual maturity class, Ed did another lesson. Shout out to Ed Gregory. Ed did another lesson about being, connected.
Right.
Talk about spiritual activity. He talked about spiritual activity and how just because you got the activity of what looks spiritual, like participating in your ministries at church, don't make you spiritual.
Right.
It's what you do when we can't see you that makes you spiritual.
Right.
It's what you say when we don't be around you that makes you spiritual.
Right.
Conversation is not connection. Just because you can pontificate the word of God in such manners that nobody can ever do, and I can make you feel what is called the emotional power of the living God by the way I change the inflections of my voice, does not mean that I am not a hoe.
Right, right, right.
Does not mean that Sister Carol after the service catch you in the back. Hallelujah.
Right, right.
Spiritual conversation does not give you spiritual connectivity.
Right.
Just because you can talk that talk, walk that walk, sing that song, play that instrument, do what you're doing, that don't mean God is with you.
Right.
I hope this is helping somebody.
Right.
Either way, I'm having a great time. Thank you for being with me today, baby. You're so fun. All right, let's move on. How did we get here? Is that a slide?
Slide 8.
Slide 8. Next 8. How did we get here? Slide 8. We almost there, y'all. How did we get here? Entitlement has destroyed my ability to wait in humility. Mm-hmm. Don't take it down yet. Good job. I just need everybody to read that one more time. Mm-hmm. Entitlement has destroyed my ability to wait in humility. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Bring it down. Mm-hmm. When you think God owes you something, you don't wait in humility. Mm-hmm. When you think your friends, your lover, your kids, somebody owes you something, you don't wait in humility. Mm-hmm. If I did dirty and I'm trying to rush her to catch up to where I am, that's not waiting mm-hmm. in humility. Mm-hmm. To wait in humility is to be still and wait patiently for something, anything that for God to respond how he chooses to respond to what's going on.
Right.
Did that make sense?
Yeah.
What?
Now, I was going to say it's the same, you know, way that sometimes we use scripture to kind of, as I like to call it, still rush God, right? We, you know, whether we use colloquialisms, right? We use these antidotes that we've heard, right? Girl, just name it and claim it. God told you to wait. You know what I'm saying? Or you know, God covers a multitude of sins, but you still are going to reap. There's still consequences, you know, from anything. But because we grab a hold of these things, and I think in a conference, I remember Rev and Renee were talking about children, right? And how our children are entitled right now, right? And they're entitled because, you know, they get trophies for everything. Even if you're in 50th place, you get a trophy, you get celebrated, right? And so you never feel what it's like, right? To have to actually push, to actually have to earn, to do anything, because everything is such a gimme, gimme, gimme. I know I'm reading, you know, the word on a phone, you know what I'm saying? But even that, right, versus having 3, 4, 5 different sort of Bibles here, going through each, you know, each thing, right? Everything is just handed to us now, right? But that all that is making us entitled, right? It's making us entitled. And so now we feel more puffed up, right? Because now we're more knowledgeable, right? And so now, what do you mean wait? I don't have to wait on anything right now in life. So what do you mean I need to wait on God? Well, no, I'm going to just Google it. I'm going to Google it for a solution for this. You acting this way, guess what? I've Googled it. I've decided that there's a term for you.
Right.
Get help. You know what I'm saying? And that's how I approach life, right? But versus actually sitting in it and actually waiting on God, right? Humbling myself, asking God to show in me the things that are not of you, right? What are the things that I need to work on? No, I don't want to see that because life right now has shown me that I can get. Why wait on God?
Why wait on God when technology makes me feel like I am God? What do I have to wait on an invisible being that I say I believe in when the internet has put me into a false sense of entitlement space mm-hmm. where I can fulfill my own issues,
right,
my own way? And if it turns out good, then I can say I've been blessed.
Right. Right.
And even if it's not blessed, the internet has also given us so many social media platforms that even if my heart is in disagreement with me, I can also find a group of people that will be in agreement with me, because right. there's a bitter group on the internet right. that will feed my bitterness. There is a lying group on the internet that will feed my lying ways.
Right.
There is a whole group on the internet that will feed right. my hoish ways.
Right. Right. So I go to the people that really don't know me, right, to gas me up. Right. I go to the people out on this social media. I tell them my situation and everybody's telling me, oh, you don't have to worry. No weapon formed against you shall prosper.
I just want the good words.
Right.
I don't want
this. But this is my thing. You don't know my relationship with God. You don't know my connection with God. You don't even know I have a connection with God, but now I'm using all of this, right? You know, now I want to believe I'm a chosen people. Now I want to believe in a God Most High, and now I'm calling because somewhere along the way, I've basically assumed that this is me, that I'm entitled to it, but I don't have to work for it, right? It's just going to be given, right? Okay, Jesus died for my, okay, it's given, but I don't have to do any work to get anything. I'm just going to reap all the blessings without doing any of the work.
Next slide. Go ahead.
All right. Some Jews who went around driving out evil spirits tried to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those who were demon possessed. They would say, "In the name of the Jesus whom Paul preaches, I command you to come out." 7 sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, were doing this. One day, the evil spirit answered them, "Jesus, I know, and Paul, I know about, but who are you?" Interesting. Then the man who had the evil spirit jumped on them and overpowered them all. He gave them such a beating that they ran out of the house naked and bleeding.
Naked and bleeding. Bring it back. See, there's going to come a time where all that spiritual talk that we talk is going to have an occasion with a real spirit that is against God.
Right.
And it's not going to come how you think it's going to come, with red horns and red makeup and a long tail and a pitchfork.
Right.
Nah. So in our season, what at least got us back to a place of civility.
Right.
Was when the spirit that I brought into my own house visited one of my children.
Right.
And then me being me, trying to be daddy, went to this child with the rebuke. Mm-hmm. And this child in the spirit that she was in. Jesus, I know.
Right.
Paul, I know.
But you?
Who the hell is you?
Right.
Who's you? You a hoe? You a hoe? I'm a hoe. We all hoes. Let's all just be hoes.
Right.
And see, it don't feel good when the spirit that you bring into your own house is the one that challenges your relationship with God for real.
Right. Right.
But it was that relationship that I have with my daughter that I realized, this is
real.
Hey, you know what? This is a quick reenactment. Hey, look, I know we got what we got going on. And it's gonna be what it's gonna be.
Right.
I don't know if you're gonna keep me. I don't know if God is gonna allow you to make me let me stay. Mm-hmm. But let me tell you something that I know we can agree on. We love her.
Right.
We love
right.
her.
Right.
And so this is what I need you to do. I know you mad, but I'm going to need you to put that on the shelf right now, because we can't fight that spirit.
Right.
With this division.
Right.
Because if we are divided, we're going to lose her forever.
Right. Right.
And so I need you to feel what you feel.
Right.
But put it on the shelf and just fight in the spirit with me.
Right.
Believing that I want the best for this whole family.
Right, right.
Fight with me. And then if at the end of all things,
right,
if we get her back to a place we need to get her, if you still decide that Will's got to go, then Will will go and we'll deal with whatever the next season is when the next season shows up. But I ain't got time to think about the next season, because right now there is a spirit there that
right.
I need to deal with, but I can't deal with it because I'm too busy dealing with the weight of my own sin.
Right.
Not only am I dealing with the weight of my own sin, this view is not big enough to handle
right.
what's coming and right. trying to take her out.
Right.
Believe what you want to believe, but I love you and I love her.
Right.
Can we put this weight down just for a second? Let God deal with that. Right. And can we go after her?
Right. It's a humbling feeling as a parent when you realize that the only way that spirit, not the only way, right? But that you know that that door was so wide open that you allowed that spirit to come in, right? And granted, yes, you have other influences and you have school and you have this, but when you know you riding dirty, right? And we both were riding dirty, not only when you know you've been riding dirty. And because of your own weights you carrying and trying to live your own life and trying to, you know, covering up and you not paying attention and taking the time with your children. And you know that spirit got in because I left it open. Because I wasn't vigilant. I wasn't on my watch and being like, no. And then not only is it open, but it take root. When I tell you that thing took root, right? And so when he came to me, you know, like this in our conversation yesterday, what we had to realize is I can't do it by myself. He couldn't do it by himself. We needed to come together, be a united front.
And believe God.
And believe God to get that spirit out of our house. Because that was what I'm telling you. That was one, actually nothing to do with this one, right? And so we had to become, so all of this weight, all of this W-E-I-G-H-T, that we had all of this friction, that we had all this chatter, that we have in that moment, we had no choice but to wait W-A-I-T on God. We had no choice but to humble ourselves, because that entitlement is just not on our kids. It's on us as parents. It's on us as leaders and having different positions. You think your child can't be touched. And then when your child is touched, it's God reminding, remember, I'm still here. Then you go into God. Now you all with the sorries. You are humbling yourself because, God, I need you to heal this land. I need you to come in here and in here. I need you to help us deal with this, because that spirit there, as Ike said, ran out naked and bleeding. Naked and bleeding.
Beat us both naked and bleeding. We run around our own house naked and bleeding.
Naked and bleeding.
Trying to figure out, hold up. Hold up.
Right, right.
hold up.
Right, right, right.
Coming face to face with the spirits that made, coming face to face with that spirit made me come face to face with what I really wanted.
Right.
Did that make sense to you?
Yes.
Coming face to face with that spirit,
right,
made me come face to face with what I really wanted.
Right.
And when I realized what I really wanted, some changes had to be made.
Right.
Immediately.
Right.
Sometimes, here's my note, sometimes you have to fight. Is that up there? Oh, yeah, throw that up. Slide 10. We're almost there. We're going to push to this last part. Sometimes you have to fight in the middle of your weight.
Right.
Sometimes you have to fight in the middle of your way. You can bring it down. Meaning whatever spirit you got to deal with, whether it's in yourself or in your space. Hey, look, while you're in, COVID is a season of wait.
Right.
You got to fight in this. You can't just give in to every whim and emotion that's trying to take you off course.
Right.
You got to fight sometimes in the middle of your way. Waiting ain't just sitting on your butt doing nothing. You got to fight. And I'm not saying throw up the hands, but I'm saying throw up the hands. Throw up the hands. Throw up the hands. Mm-hmm. You got to fight. Proverbs 18:21. Do we have that one? What is that? Y'all got Proverbs 18:21? Can you bring that up?
That's
slide 12. We got one more slide. Let's go.
Slide 12.
It's okay. Come on. Slide 12. Give me that. What does that say?
The Amplified
version. Yeah, read that for me.
It says, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it and indulge it will eat its fruit and bear the consequences of their words.
Bring it back down. What does all of this that we've been talking about have to do with lifting your voice? What is everything we talked about? What does that have to do with lifting your voice? Here's my note. Is that slide 2?
Slide 11.
Slide 11. Bring that last, bring slide 11 up. Is that 11?
Yeah, that's 11.
This is what it has to do. In order to lift your voice, you have to know what is weighing it down. Otherwise, you are only lifting your weight and not your voice. Bring it on down. In order to lift your voice, you have to know what's weighing your voice down.
Mm-hmm.
See, the situation that we just talked through and talked about with you guys, that was weighing our voices down.
Mm-hmm.
That's why when I went to raise my voice at the spirit that dared to come into my house to my children, my voice couldn't be heard because I wasn't lifting my voice. I was lifting the weight of what we had going on.
Right.
And the weight of what we had going on has no power in dealing with real spirits.
Right.
So you have to know, woo, what weight is in your voice.
Right.
Because when you go to lift your voice, because there's going to come a time that you're going to have to lift your voice for a reason. And what you don't want to have happen is that you go to lift your voice and you have no voice. All you got is weights. All you got is the weight of the situations that you just can't see past.
Right.
All you got is the weight of that heaviness you're carrying around.
Right.
There's going to come a time where you got to lift your voice. But if the heaviness is the only thing holding you down,
right,
that's what you will be lifting.
Right.
You want to add?
Go ahead.
My last two notes. Why can I say all of this? Because the voice that God gave you and the voice that God gave me sounds and looks like something.
Right. Right.
See, the reason why we were able to reconnect and say we got to fight for her because we love her is because we realized, hey, we got the power to defeat that spirit.
Right. Right.
But we can't do it with this weight in our mouth.
Right.
We can't do it with this weight in our mouth. I'm able to have that conversation with her because once upon a time, before Stupid entered the picture, she met and knew she married a man of God.
Right. Right.
And I knew that I chose a woman of God.
Right.
And so in spite of all the bumps and bruises that go in the middle of a journey, we can always go back to the foundation of, you know what?
Right.
We know who we serve and we know who we belong to.
Right.
And it is on that reality, it is on that truth that we're going to go after that.
Right.
No longer can we lift the voice of weight.
Right.
I need to lift the voice that God gave me to lift.
Right.
I've got a voice.
And
Ty Trippett said it best in his song. I can't remember the name of the song, but the words go like this. Devil, if you only knew
right.
what I was going to be after this storm,
right.
you never would have bothered me.
Right.
If you only knew what I was going to be after the storm, you never would have bothered me. You need to find your voice, God's people.
Right.
What's happening right now is just a storm. And just like every storm, storms pass by. It's not raining outside every day, always.
Right.
Tornadoes come through, tear everything up, and then they go about their business.
Right.
Hurricanes make a big old mess. And then what do? You rebuild.
Right.
You restore.
Right.
The storm does not stay there. Otherwise, if the storm remained always, always, then it's an inhabitable place that you cannot live.
Right, right, right. And the trick is to keep you in a place of you feeling like you are helpless, right? The trick is to keep you in a place so weighed down that you forget what God's voice actually feels like. You forget, right, what it sounds like. You forget that his voice gives you that power. As the word said, death and life are in the power of your tongue. What are you speaking? What are you speaking to your situation? What are you speaking to your circumstance? A lot of times we're so weighted down by what we're going through. We are speaking nothing but death. God's people, you are life. Speak life. Speak life into your spouse, into your friends. Speak life. Right? I was so blessed by Mon Cloud reading that scripture that Will and I said here. And we said, you know, we forgot about that scripture. But the scripture said we are hard pressed on every side, but we are not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. As Will said, the storm will come and the storm will go. But you are, as God's people, you are there. You are staying firm. There is a foundation that you are standing on. That in the midst of everything that's going on, but God got you this far. We're here today because of God. Nothing, there's nothing, no knowledge that Will and Joy knew to get them over their hump, but God.
And so this is where we close out and we pass it on. If there is power of life and death in your tongue, what are you using your power on? If there is power of life and death in your tongue, what are you using your powers for? See, I'm surrounded all my life. I probably wanted to be a superhero. I even got training to become a version of a superhero because I admire them. But what they do, what you do with your power, either makes you a superhero or a villain. Either brings life to a situation or death. What are you doing with your power? Last slide, and this is where we pass it over. when God returns his voice to you, you remember you are not helpless. Bring it back. This is where we pass it on. When God returns his voice to you, you remember that God is power. And so if the voice, the powerful voice of God is in you and he returned that voice to you, then you go into every situation remembering who you belong to, because you've got the power of God's voice coming out of your mouth. And because of that reality, God's people, you are not helpless. So stop acting like it. I pray this blessed you. Thank you all for joining us this morning. Until next time, we're going to pass this on.
Amen. Praise God for that message. Listen to me, family. Hopefully you heard something very key here. We must examine our hearts through and through. Allow God to examine us and to prune us. A tree and its fruit must go through a pruning process. It is impossible for it to produce fruit unless it's been pruned, it has been nurtured, and the process of patience for it to grow into something magnificent for God's kingdom. This message of evaluating what our heart desires is so vital that it shows up in the Bible multiple times. Matthew and Luke both highlighted the words of Yeshua almost verbatim in Matthew 12, verse 35, and in Luke 6, verse 45. Thus it reads, "A good man brings good things out of the good stored in him, and an evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored in him. But I tell everyone that you will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every useless, uttered word, idle word that comes from your mouth. You must be held to an account for every action that you do on this earth, family." And in Luke, it highlights so very clearly that for out of the heart, the mouth speaks. What does that mean? That means I must take the time to evaluate me. I must take the time to ask God, where am I missing the mark? I must take time to ask God to mend a broken heart. Life circumstances, the trauma that Will spoke about, the hardships, our hearts have been broken. There's some aches and pains there that have been lingering for many years. But God is saying, I want to heal you now. But I can't heal you unless you want to be healed. Do you want to be healed? Do you want wholeness in your life? Do you want peace in your life? Do you want love in your life? What does your heart desire? This week, take some time to write in your journal what it is that my heart desires, what it is that I want, and am I being intentional of trying to reach that goal? God will bless you. God will show up. But you must be willing to endure the process. The other thing that popped in my head was something very clear. Am I desiring to build a worldly image, or am I desiring to do the will of the Lord? Am I desiring to present myself appeasing or appealing to people and man, or am I presenting myself to be appealing to the God in heaven? You can't do both. Let your yeas be yea and your nay be nay. Let your truth be shown and your light exemplified amongst men. Let your presence be one of who God called you to be. And every space I enter, that energy should shift. It should be a shift. If there's chaos, there should be peace. For every space I enter into, if there's hate, there should be love. And if not, I must evaluate. What is that thing that's inside my soul that's keeping me from the love of God? You have a right to be free. You have a right to love and to just be in a space of joy. You have a right to be at the foot of God's throne 24 hours of the day and just be loved by him. Stop allowing the barriers to keep you from that position. Your choice, your actions, your speech and conduct is the only thing that can separate you from the love of God. Your choice, your actions, your speech, your conduct is the only thing that can connect you back to the love of God. So don't allow yourself, family, to be held captive any longer. set your soul free and let God use you. Let God love you, lead you and direct you and protect you. Let me pray for you. Dear Heavenly Father, there are some burdens that your children are carrying right now. There are some hardships that are being pressed from both sides, God. And we need you now more than ever, God. So please bring your loving and confident hand and free them, God, from these cells. Free them from these prisons and let them see that they already have the keys that they possess. They already have the keys of life through the word of God, through their prayer and petition. You already have the keys, my family. God, let them be relieved. Let them be able to breathe again and no longer submerged under this water and drown into this life, but be able to live and prosper in the spirit. Help us, God, to remove anything inside of us that is not of you. I pray that we will become whole and one with the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and that we will walk in accordance to the light, the will, and the way. That our hearts will desire nothing but your will be done. And when we pray that, God, and your will is being done, that we will not be complaining, but have a spirit of thanksgiving in the midst of it. That we will wholeheartedly run to you, God, with our arms stretched wide and not look back on anything of this world, because we know it's only temporary, but your kingdom is forever. I pray, God, for every heart that beats, that we will have a loving and personal encounter with you, and that there will be nothing to separate us from the love of God. God, you gave us this day. You gave us this daily bread for us to use it to the fullest of its advantage, for us to heal and reveal who you are to the world around us, Father, for us to be the beacons of light that you called us to be. Let your will be done. And God, for anybody that's in this season of misunderstanding and confusion, let them know, God, how valuable they are. You are so valuable, my family. You have a life that is so abundant. You have somebody else that can be healed by your wounds. Just be present in the position in the space of God and let him work with you. Thank you, God, for the gift of life. Thank you, God, for the gift of words. Thank you, God, for the presence that you possess in everything that we do around the world, Father. This is a space that you have called us in, and we will be warriors for your kingdom. We thank you for the privilege and the honor to come before your throne. We thank you for the privilege and the honor to be called children of the Most High God. We love you, God. We love you, Father. We love everything about who you are. We love the essence of who you are, God. We love the ability to be in a space of believers, Father. Let your will be done. And all those in agreement say, amen. Amen and amen.